across Wisconsin from Civic Media. This is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
Well, hey there, Wisconsin. Good morning. It is 6:06 on this Monday morning, March 4th, 2024. It's another beautiful day to have you here up north, live from Lake Wissota. From wherever you're listening, across the Civic Media Radio Network, through the app, through social media, or later on by podcast. Nice to have you along on this Monday as we get the day going. I've got a question for you. When was the last time you played Flora's Lava? And I don't mean the TV show version, which I haven't seen, but I guess there's a version of it. But just, you know, played it with some little kids. That was a lot of what I did this weekend, heading out to Kalamazoo and visiting the soon-to-be 5-year-old and the soon-to-be 2-year-old, and there was a lot of lava monster going on here. So if my voice is a little raspy, it's because I've been a monster all weekend to a couple of little ones. So that was fun. Our number here is 855-75-CIVIC, and you can let us know what games do you still play with the little ones, or maybe Greg, that's how parkour got started, is people wanted to continue playing Flora's Lava into their adult years and just leaping from couches to chairs and things.
I can't hear that word without thinking of The Office. Parkour! And just running all over the parkour!
That's right.
I wanted to do parkour a long time ago, and then I never did, and now I never will, and that's okay. But no. Yeah, it's... It's
if I'd
fun.
Have known about it as a kid, yeah, that would have been great.
It's, but though, I mean, I have a little niece. I have a niece. She's going to turn 6 next week, and I have a nephew who's going to turn 3. And they don't play specific games like you would with your little ones. It's mm-hmm. just a game called "How fast can we run around and how loud can we scream?"
I love that game.
Yeah.
Yeah, my younger daughter, who lives in Michigan now, you know, they're relatively new homeowners. Yeah. And I think in any home, little kids look for the circle. And in this case, it's, you know, living room to hallway to kitchen to dining room, yeah, back to the living room. And that circle gets so worn out over time. It did over the weekend, yeah, here for us, too. And, yeah, I wouldn't say that Lava Monster has any real rules, except that you growl at each other, and eventually they get brave enough to tackle Grandpa.
And there's a lot of giggling.
And there's so much giggling, a lot of it from Grandpa, who realizes that he's no longer strong enough to just throw these two little beasts off and get up, you know, with any kind of speed whatsoever.
Oh, that's so cute.
It was wonderful. Here's what's coming up on the program. By the way, those were the words of Greg Bach in Waukesha. We're going to check in more with him throughout the show here. You know, women are going to decide how this presidential election goes. There's just no two ways around it. And look, when every vote matters, don't get me wrong, every subgroup of voters is important. You know, Black voters are going to decide this election, or relatively new citizens. Any small group can do it. We're going to talk about the role that women are going to play in Wisconsin, and that is clear again this week, as both the First Lady of the United States and the Vice President of the United States, Jill Biden and Kamala Harris, come to Wisconsin this week. Jill Biden yesterday and Kamala Harris coming up later this week. In our second hour, we'll talk to Up North News reporter Selena Heller, and her new report is a reminder that Wisconsin used to require teaching comprehensive sex and health education, that you couldn't just be guessing your way through this. You had to have a curriculum that was based in science. Scott Walker and the Republicans got rid of that and said, not only do schools not have to teach sex ed, but if you do, it's basically saying abstinence only, which, again, abstinence is a part of comprehensive sex ed, to say that's the thing that, you know, would be most effective. But here are answers to some other questions before you go finding it out, you know, on the internet or from your friends who are going to guess wrong or whatever the case may be. So Selena will talk more about that. And then our guest at 7:30 is a former U.S. attorney for the Western District of Wisconsin. And we're going to talk about court security, because there's a new alarming report by the U.S. Marshals Service that reviewed an increase in threats targeted at federal judges and prosecutors. And we'll be talking to John Vaudrey, courtesy of the group Keep Our Republic, which you'll recall is a bipartisan group that is meant to remind Americans that the 2020 elections were, in fact, secure and safe, and that there is a greater need than ever to have that level of trust in all of the good men and women who administer our elections. But part of that as well is dealing with the increasing number of threats in our courts and toward our elections officials and things like that. So we'll talk to John Vaudreuil later on about that. Terry Bell will have three things that you need to know to get the week started. Brittany Merlot is off for a couple of days here, so I want to let you know about temperatures across the area for the 6 a.m. hour. They are pretty close to where they were on Friday morning when I joined you from Kalamazoo. Here in Lake Wissota, it is 36 degrees. Hayward's at 35. Park Falls, 34. Wausau, you're at 29 degrees right now. Green Bay, 34. La Crosse, 38. Wisconsin Rapids reporting 30 degrees right now. Listeners to Oshkosh Air Support, you're at 36. Madison's at 35, and it is 37 down by Greg there in Waukesha. The interesting thing, Greg, about going to different parts of the country is to see things like what do they like for food and drink? And I can tell you this much about my now more frequent trips to southwestern Michigan is that, well, first off, you know, there are wineries and things and distilleries and things like that. But, man, they still, you leave Wisconsin, you cannot get a really great old-fashioned from any one place consistently. You might be able to find a bartender who, you know, knows how to make you one. But that's still a tall order, apparently, for a lot of places. I need to stop ordering old-fashions outside Wisconsin. That's all I can figure. But I keep trying. But the other thing in that southwestern part of Michigan, I don't know if it's the whole state, man, they love their mac and cheese. I mean, every menu, every place is mac and cheese that is dressed up nine ways to Sunday, you know, with bacon or chicken or, I mean, it's everything but walleye. Actually, you can get salmon, you know, for your mac and cheese. Yeah. Every place. When I went to a hockey game there, I've gone to a couple hockey games there now. And at the concession stands, that's, you know, where we would have brats. They have mac and cheese and the different ways that you can order mac and cheese. I don't know how it got started or why, but as a mac and cheese, you know, lover myself, I applaud that. You know, I'll make up for you not being able to make a good old fashioned with, you know, some good mac and cheese.
I love mac and cheese. And I think I've said this before it wasn't until the late aughts that I knew that mac and cheese was a thing that restaurants serve. Not fancy, but like, oh, our mac and cheese has Gruyere with crumble and blah, blah. I'm like, what? Like, I just opened a box, throw some powder in a pot, and I'm happy. But the question I have with the old fashioned is it because, so like in Wisconsin, of course, we're big fans of brandy old fashions. I feel like that's the norm. And I know that because when I went to Canada last year, a bartender actually said to my face, he said, that's not a thing. I go, yeah, it is a thing. I was like deeply offended by the fact that he just poo-pooed my thought. But is it because they use bourbon or just because they get it right?
Or bourbon or just pretty much any kind of whiskey. And of course, you know, a lot of times it's something that's locally made, which again, as somebody of a little more older, discerning palate, I'd like my bourbon aged 9 years, not 9 months, you know, but then, you know, they throw all kinds of other, you know, things in there. And I'm looking up it's got golden turmeric syrup. Just simple syrup will do just fine. And, you know, there's, that may come with like pear syrup or elderflower or something. It's like, no, just the basics will do. Anything else? And then there's always, and this is a hill I'm willing to die on.
Yeah.
The single ice cube the size of a beach ball that they put in the glass. Again, I know what they'll say is, well, that's, you know, because if you just put ice cubes or crushed ice in there, it melts too fast and waters down your drink. I don't want a beach ball or just a solid block of ice in the glass when I'm drinking something.
If a bartender is worth their salt, they're going to place the ice in there carefully for a drink like that. If they're going for a creative cocktail, they're going to gently place the ice in there so it doesn't break, so it doesn't melt. But I don't disagree with you. I feel like the beach ball or the the ice cube that's the size of a block of cheese, along with all that other stuff. That's just their way of saying, we're going to charge you $3 more.
That's exactly what it is. So now again, not poisonous. I didn't not finish it, but, and then we went to another place. Look, I know a lot of hockey rinks and places have concession stands. Like I mentioned a few minutes ago, this place was like a sports bar inside of a community hockey rink. Like a really nice sports bar at the upper level, so you could sit at tables and look down at the hockey. And I'm sure there's more of them. I just hadn't been to one like this one. And I immediately thought that was just a genius idea, that rather than just more, I don't know, locker room space or storage space, they had the presence of mind, you know, to put a bar restaurant in there. And you know, a good quality one. So I appreciated that. I get all kinds of ideas for food and drink and businesses, you know, while I'm away here. Let's do some sports real quick. At 6:17, the Milwaukee Bucks, they beat the Bulls on Friday. So they now have a 5-game winning streak since the All-Star break, and they gave up fewer than 100 points for the fourth consecutive game. And by the way, in that game on Friday, Giannis Antetokounmpo passed Sidney Moncrief as the winningest Milwaukee player. Of all the players who've ever put on a Bucks uniform, none had 489 wins as a Buck, including the playoffs, until Giannis as of Friday. They are back in action at home at the Fiserv Forum tonight, hosting the LA Clippers. And you can catch that game on several Civic Media radio stations. Check out civicmedia.us or the Civic Media app to learn more. The still slumping Badger men's basketball team fell to number 13, Illinois, on Saturday. Since the Kohl Center opened in 1998, no visiting team has had a 4-game win streak in the building until now. For the Illini, the Badgers have lost 7 of the last 9 games. They will host Rutgers on Thursday. The 5th-ranked Marquette men's basketball team, missing 2 of their starters, fell at 12th-ranked Creighton on Saturday. They will host UConn on Wednesday. The Badger men's hockey team split with Michigan State over the weekend. The Spartans' win on Friday gave them the Big Ten regular season title, but next will come the conference tournament. The Badgers have a first-round face-off against Ohio State at the Kohl Center starting Friday night. And the Badger women's hockey team swept St. Thomas in the first round of the conference tournament and move on to the Final Four of the WCHA tournament this weekend in the Twin Cities. Wherever you're listening across Wisconsin on this Monday morning, when you're here, you're up north, live from Lake Wissota on the Civic Media Radio Network. My daughter would go insane knowing that their dad, who used to mock them for listening to the Spice Girls many, many, many years ago, is now playing Spice Girls as bumper music. But also because they're part of the This Day in History segment, so I can make them feel a little older
just
that way,
too. Just like it already.
I do. Why do you think I keep it? I wouldn't put it in if I didn't otherwise. Mostly because I loved watching them dance to it all the time. It was adorable. They'd be the first to tell you that. So anyway, we'll tell you more about why the Spice Girls are in today's history lesson coming up. Craig, I was able to pull the curtain back just now, and that's not even a metaphor. We're at the point now at 6:21. I can open the curtain.
I know.
I can see the cornfield across the street, and I can see the lake out the other side. It's amazing.
Give it a week.
I know. It's sad. What do we got for today? Where's my sunrise, sunset? 6:36 is the actual sunrise time today, and it now sets at 5:57. It will soon be after 6 o'clock, and it will not be earlier than 6 p.m. again until, like, November. That would be so nice. I can't wait.
Me too. I'm a big fan. I'm a big fan of spring forward. I like longer days. I like a Tuesday in June where it's just 8:30 and still light.
Go ahead.
No, I was going to say when I understand that we lose an hour of sleep, but I'm also like, get over it.
Yeah. Yep. It will be it will take almost a month until, you know, after next week when the sun, you know, comes up an hour later, it'll take about a month to get back to this. But just having this little period right here is just a nice reminder that, again, the worst parts of winter are, you know, have come to an end. We got through this relatively unscathed.
Yeah.
And that is just a load off. Trust me. We have a busy week ahead. We'll be talking to Wausau Mayor Katie Rosenberg tomorrow morning. We'll be talking about PFAS contamination, the legislature continuing to sit on funds that could remediate PFAS pollution in Wisconsin drinking water. And there's even dark money that is showing up in the mayor's race in Wausau as Katie Rosenberg runs for another term. We'll talk about that tomorrow. We'll also talk to our friend Hans Breitenmoser about how there has been a lot of rural economic development in terms of project awards announced recently, both through the Biden administration and the Evers administration. So we'll talk about making rural development a priority and who's actually doing that for rural Wisconsin. On Wednesday, we'll have the hosts of the Busted Pencil Show, which is now heard five nights a week here on Civic Media, a 6 p.m. show that we have for you now. Also on Wednesday, Congressman Mark Pocan will be joining us. He comes in about once a month or so. And obviously, we have a lot of ground to cover because there is still not a final federal budget for this year yet, even though we're coming up on, 5 months now overdue, something like that. So we'll talk to Congressman Pocan about that. And then on Thursday, Kristen Lyerly is back with us, and we'll be talking with another state Senate candidate from Northeast Wisconsin, who will be talking again a bit about the new maps and the decision to run for office, which obviously nobody takes lightly here. Courier Newsroom has a new podcast out. It's called Vibes Only. Oh, hang on, gotta reach for my Jamaican cool vibes stuff for that. Brian Derrick and Glennis Mahar have the Vibes Only podcast, and this week's edition features Emily Amick, former counsel for the Senate Judiciary Committee. She goes by the Instagram handle Emily in Your Phone and does a lot of news explainers. And Glennis and Brian will also talk about the recent CPAC conference where attendees were bragging about ending democracy. We mentioned on Friday that it is Women's History Month now in the month of March, and in the Up North News daily newsletter that Christina Laurie puts together, there's a lot of emphasis on Women's History Month to kick off the week here. There are several Badger State connections to Women's History Month that she mentions. For example, Angie Brooks was the first African woman to serve as president of the UN General Assembly. She graduated with a law degree and a master's degree in political science from the University of Wisconsin. And Christina tells us about more women leaders and their Wisconsin ties. And she also talks about the state of Wisconsin's women-owned businesses. So a lot to look over by going to upnorthnewswi.com. Click on newsletter in the top banner and be a part of what we put together every weekday morning. Well, as mentioned, First Lady Jill Biden did come to Waukesha on Sunday, and Vice President Kamala Harris is set to travel to Madison this week. I was just looking for, here it is, Hope Carnop's article in the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel reports that First Lady Jill Biden spoke to a crowd of about 100 women in Waukesha, continuing the Democratic message that abortion and health care access are at stake in the 2024 election. She was making a weekend tour of battleground states that included Georgia, Arizona, and Nevada. She targeted, of course, former President Trump, saying he is considering a national abortion ban and is taking credit for all the various state bans that have gone into effect. Jill Biden said, "We are the first generation in half a century to give our daughters a country with fewer rights than we had. Women put Joe Biden in the White House, and women are going to do it again." And of course, we've got the Vice President, Kamala Harris, is coming later this week as well. And she's going to be talking about apprenticeships and job training. And that we talked about that on Friday, how that has been an increasingly cited message by Biden and Democrats about apprenticeships and about blue-collar jobs. Because it just seems like a whole lot of Americans still do not know or appreciate the record growth in manufacturing jobs during the Biden administration. And it always seems like when you mention that, people say, well, yeah, that's just recovery from the pandemic. No. This is recovery from the pandemic and then more than has ever been done before. And that's something that, again, the Biden administration and the Biden campaign need to be talking about, is the amount of blue-collar jobs that are created and continue to be created. Meanwhile, Republicans, well, they're working on, you know, tax cuts for the very wealthy. And when we come back on the other side of the upcoming break, we're going to be talking about how Governor Evers has finally taken action on Republican bills where they tried yet again to pass tax cuts that were geared primarily toward the very wealthy. And it's just, it's not a solid economic plan. Makes for great tweets in an election year, but that's about it. So we'll talk about that coming up in just a bit here. And also, the state Supreme Court decided Friday not to hear a challenge to the congressional maps. Now, the state Supreme Court did throw out the legislative maps, and now we have new maps that are fairer and more competitive, a lot of new boundaries to learn for voters and candidates. But the court did not take up the case challenging the congressional districts, so they will stay in place. So what we're stuck with in Wisconsin is the current situation is that in a 50-50 state, which is what Wisconsin is, Republicans have 75% of the seats in the House of Representatives, 6-2, because of the way that the lines were drawn many years ago. Justice Janet Protasiewicz did not participate in that one because she wasn't on the court when the case was originally brought. All right, we'll pause here for the Midwest Farm Report, and then we'll unpack some more of the news for this Monday morning on Up North News Radio. Back in a bit. Welcome back to Up North News for a Monday morning. Are we letting people down, Greg?
Is that no.
The need for the Beatles this morning?
No, ma'am. No. We're just telling people, don't let us down. Go vote.
I like that. Very nice.
Thank you.
I like the public.
Did I just come up with that off the top of my head? Absolutely.
Public service announcements through bumper music. All right. We had fun on Friday talking about Eric Hovde breaking the ice, as it were. And standing in a cold lake and saying, see, I'm a Wisconsinite just like you. You see what he did later that night afterwards that he put up a video doing?
Did he like just...
Axe throwing.
Oh, my God. I don't even know anyone in the state who does that.
And if you do, that's fine. But, I mean, the term that is used a lot in social media is thirst trap. And it's like, I wonder, I think the guy is married, but with family, he's acting like the middle-aged crisis of a man who's recently divorced and has got to really prove that manhood out there by standing in a frozen lake and throwing an axe. And I put up something on TikTok right afterwards, and I can't take credit. It was one of my daughters who came up with it. You see him in the lake, you see him throwing the axe, and because of that mustache of his, it's followed immediately by a clip of Ron Burgundy going, I am a man. I am a man who built the Eiffel Tower with steel. He's giving off a Ron Burgundy vibe.
I want to see him throwing the axe, and then he turns around and the camera comes in real close and he goes, can you throw an axe, Tammy Baldwin?
Oh, expect it, you know. Ugh. What he did do, which was kind of cringeworthy, is he did the kind of the shooter McGavin after he threw the axe. Pointed the two fingers, like little finger guns, at the camera. It was either the two finger guns or the two thumbs up. However it looked, it looked cringeworthy either way.
Oh, God. Who is advising him?
Here's what I really like, though, about Tammy Baldwin's response when it came to the frozen lake thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, she did put up a little tweet that said no.
Yeah.
You know? But then the other thing she did later that day, or her office, was put out a note about the work that she's doing to keep the Great Lakes clean. So it's like a very passive aggressive type of response of, yeah, you're standing on a lake. That's great. I'm busy trying to save the Great Lakes.
Yeah.
How do you like them apples?
She's literally building bridges.
Yes. So, and now what she's doing as well here, again, is talking about, you know, serious issues that are in front of people. And Friday, she and Governor Evers put out an updated story about how northern Wisconsin businesses affected by the lack of winter snow can apply for assistance through the Small Business Administration. They have been working to, again, secure some aid. Different counties have different deadline dates. And so here's the address if you're considering looking at more here through the SBA, the Small Business Administration. It's lending.sba.gov, lending.sba.gov. And go there and you'll find out more about some of the relief that's there. Because again, not everything is a natural disaster like a tornado or a hurricane. There's sometimes like this very dry winter, which again, a lot of folks enjoy, but it's absolutely killing some small businesses in the area. I'm looking up right outside. We have a snowmobile trail. So you see the little stop signs, a little stop ahead, all the poles. They never got used once this year. Trails never opened.
Yeah, I don't get it. Like Tammy Baldwin works so hard to get so much for everybody. She works for everybody. And meanwhile, this guy, I'm looking at it right now. And this is, he does sort of a bro Spider-Man. If you're watching the live stream, he does this. He goes like,
yes.
Pew, pew, pew. Yeah. I'm Eric Hovde, man. Pew, 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 pew.
Pew, pew. Yeah.
He is so awkward.
If that's not one of the more cringeworthy moments of the morning, let me give you another one. Senator Ron Johnson leaves open the possibility of running for Republican leader in the Senate now that Mitch McConnell is stepping down.
Oh, man.
This is according to The Hill, which reported over the weekend that Ron Johnson is leaving the door open. He talked to a News Nation reporter who asked on The Hill Sunday whether he'd consider taking the job, noting that he sent a letter to his GOP colleagues asking about the process for electing the new leader. Johnson said the letter was meant to encourage Republicans to come together and define their role and their party goals, which sounds a little better if you were to play the Russian national anthem music below that as I'm describing, you know, what exactly is going to be the party's role and the party's message. And what he said is, in terms of replacing the leader, McConnell, this letter is primarily, you know, I don't think people truly understand the profound dysfunction within Congress. Oh, I disagree.
Oh, I think we know.
I think we do. I think a lot of it was discussed with Mitch McConnell's retirement. But can you imagine? Actually, no, I can't imagine, because while he is certainly boisterous, certainly has his share of bravado, I don't think he could get 15 votes if he ran for leader. I definitely get that impression. And again, he's been around long enough. I've heard enough people in Congress talk about him. I don't think he would win an election to be Republican leader in the Senate.
I don't think so either. I think you get a lot of, oh, you're serious? Okay. And you
he
know,
was
you
serious. He wrote it in his diary. So
you think about the Russian national anthem, which is fair. He did spend July 4th, 2018 there and no one knows why, but as a man who now touts the journalistic integrity of the Epoch Times. Mm-hmm. I know anytime you say Ron Johnson, I just think of one thing and one thing only.
So many conspiracies. So many conspiracies.
I mean, it basically got him his third term. He didn't want to run for a third term. He said he wasn't going to, but he said he had work to do because of the COVID crisis.
The truth is out there.
Yeah.
And that's
and the truth that's is you'll never be this the majority leader.
No, but it keeps your name in the news.
Yeah.
You know, we're talking about him now. Back within the confines of the state capitol, Governor Evers late last week vetoed three Republican tax bills, saying that they threatened to drain away the state's surplus, not just the surplus, even the rainy day fund, just to offer up an election year tax giveaway that would send a lot of its relief to households making six-figure incomes. Now, Republicans who voted to pass the bills in February They claimed the bills were designed to make Wisconsin more attractive for families, middle-income earners, and retirees. Democrats said there are better ways to do that. And let me make that point right now. The Republican bill would reduce the state income tax rate for a larger amount of taxpayers. For taxpayers making between $38,000 a year and $150,000 a year. So somebody making only $38,000 a year would pay the same rate as somebody making $150,000 this year. And Greg, total pop quiz, unless you've already looked, do you know what the state income tax rate is in that particular bracket?
7.
No.
No, what is it?
It's a great guess, though. 5.3 currently, and it would shrink it down to 4.4.
What?
But again, when they talk about making Wisconsin more attractive for families, middle-income earners, who knows what their state income tax rate is and whether that's a fact. Oh, it's going from 4.3 to, it's going from 5.3 to 4.4, Edna. We're moving to Wisconsin. We're moving to Wisconsin. It's a 4.4 rate. That's not going to do it.
Yeah.
That's never been a determinant. It's great for politicians. They know tax rates.
Yeah.
Most folks want to know, is my school good? Are the roads good? You know, is my kid or my grandkid going to be hated for who they are, or for, you know, whether they want to be a teacher or not or something? Anyway, by dropping the tax rate into such a wide swath of income levels, Evers said that, you know, taken together, the three bills would have reduced state revenues by such a margin that it would likely force the state, even with ordinary revenue growth, to have to dip into its rainy day fund. And I add parenthetically, and I will always add this parenthetically, the state's rainy day fund was at a healthy level when COVID started, and Republicans running the legislature never dipped into it once. In fact, they never came back from a 9-month vacation in the year 2020. So they wouldn't use the rainy day fund for the biggest emergency of our lifetimes to date, a COVID pandemic that was killing thousands and thousands of Wisconsinites. But they're willing to drain the rainy day fund for tax cuts for people with 6 incomes. Evers said that now already he has signed plenty of tax cuts that were offered up during his, you know, roughly 5 years in office so far. And he said he has signed tax cuts that impacted 86% of Wisconsin taxpayers who are getting an income tax cut of 15% or more. So again, that's about 2.5 million taxpayers who, since Governor Evers has been in office, have received an income tax cut of 15% or more. And as we've said repeatedly on this show, the numbers don't lie. Wisconsin's tax burden is one of the lowest in history, one of the lowest on record in our lifetimes. The percentage of total household income that's going to state and local taxes is less than it's ever been, and it's quite low among many other states. Now, people say, well, I still got to pay taxes. Yeah, we do. We like the roads. Again, we like the schools. And it's not the income tax bracket that's going to determine that. It's going to be electing people who understand the role of taxes in an economy, that understand the role of spending in an economy, to make the economy healthier and more attractive. That's what brings people in. That's what helps create jobs. Evers has yet to take action on a fourth Republican bill that would expand a child tax credit that did have bipartisan support. He has until tomorrow to sign or veto it. That measure would allow qualifiers to match the state credit to the federal child care tax credit. Currently, qualifiers in Wisconsin can claim only 50% of the federal credit. That means the amount of eligible expenses under the state credit would grow from $3,000 to $10,000 for one qualifying dependent, and from $6,000 to $20,000 for two or more dependents. So we'll see if the governor does anything with that today or tomorrow. One more thing to tell you about here. And by the way, if I didn't note it at the top of the segment here, I noted earlier that Kristen Lierley is off today, but she will be back on Thursday. And Selena Heller will be joining us in just a few minutes here. But there was one other story over the weekend. It came from Dan Bice out at the Journal Sentinel. And it was about how a group called Opportunity Wisconsin, a liberal group that has been active in congressional races, is looking for a new staffer. And the staffer with the job title Eau Claire Regional Lead says they would mobilize grassroots, grass tops, leaders, and constituents on key issues while targeting Republican Congressman Derek Van Orden. Responsibilities include maintain a drumbeat of accountability, tactics, and actions through everything from holding press conferences and town halls to engaging in stunts to win media attention. And the word stunts is what stuck out for Dan Bice and others who said, you know, what exactly do you mean by that? And Opportunity Wisconsin responded, saying, we are always looking for creative ways to highlight important economic policies and connect with people about the state. And the reality is that the hollowing out of local press means we have to work harder than ever before. Megan Rowe, the program director for Opportunity Wisconsin, said that could mean creating a lifelike puppet meant to illustrate Van Orden's support for big business, or delivering, you know, material to Representative Brian Stiles' office to mark his vote against the Inflation Reduction Act. And the fact of the matter is, stunts maybe wasn't the best choice of words, but it's always been a part of politics to one degree or another. And sometimes these things get reported on and sometimes they don't. It's something called earned media, where a group will try to earn media, earn free attention for something that they do. Again, maybe not necessarily the word you would want to use in a job description, but as they were getting pushback from it, they made the point that with less reporting than ever before about political races, it's as important as ever to try to get people's attention, especially when they're just scrolling through social media. They're looking for something visual that catches their eye and makes them want to read more about the person representing them in Congress. Today's history lesson and more coming up next. You're up north.
I'm in love for the first time. Don't you know it's gonna last?
This is not a case of Pat being passive-aggressive by playing White Christmas on a day where the sun is actually shining now. The sun is up at 6:51. But that's not the reason that we're playing White Christmas, along with Greg Bach and Selena Heller joining us from Eau Claire. Selena, good morning. How are you?
Good morning. Good. I thought, what time is it? And the light out. I'm like, oh, my goodness.
That I mentioned earlier that, you know, we were visiting a couple of the grandkids, and I kid you not, on Saturday morning, after a rough night, because the soon-to-be two-year-old is potty training and, you know, had an accident overnight and things like that. And here we were finally back to sleep, and it was a little after six. And the soon-to-be five-year-old kind of toddles in and says those infamous words, Grandma, Grandpa, the sun is up. We kind of half opened an eye, looked at the window. It's like, no, it's not. No, it is. No, it's not. The sun's not up.
Great. Go tell your parents.
Yeah.
Get them up. They want to play.
Oh, no. We were there to give the parents a little break. So that was our good deed for the weekend, is they did get to sleep in a little bit here. Now, the reason that we're playing White Christmas is that it was at the Academy Awards ceremony on this day in 1943 that Irving Berlin was presenting the Oscar for Best Original Song, which he won for White Christmas. And he remains to this day the only presenter to ever win the award that he presented. Because at this point, the Academy Award went, hey, maybe that's not a great idea. The winner is me.
And the winner
it's
is
about me.
This is my trophy.
Yes.
Yeah, that is weird.
I claim this in honor of myself. I would like to thank myself. I'd like to thank me. That would be great.
A little more anticlimactic.
Yes. Let's do some birthdays here. Let's do with, I've always said Chris Rea, but it could be Chris Rea, the singer who had the 1978 hit Fool If You Think It's Over. He is 73 today.
Dying
He's much more of a song, known for his songwriting than his singing, but he did earn a Grammy nomination for Best New Artist of 1978 with that hit that is still played on yacht rock stations to this day.
You love yacht rock.
I do so much. I'm not, I will just have that on constantly someday in the retirement home. Okay. That's all you're going to hear, you know?
He and thinks this place is his yacht. Just let him do it. Let him have it. Let's let him have it.
That's, that should totally be my retirement gift, is a captain's hat. I'm the captain now. Catherine O'Hara is 70 years old today. Woo! Just a funny lady. Actress Patricia Heaton is 66. The city of Chicago was incorporated on this day in 1837. Happy anniversary, Chicago. And in New York City, the first Congress of the United States met, putting the Constitution into effect. By the way, so that was the first Congress. We are in the 118th Congress, just in case you were keeping score.
Thanks.
Let me get back to 1978 for a moment, because there was something unusual happening on the charts on this day. First, I'm going to play this little clip of a song that, again, everybody knows on oldie stations, from Dan Hill, and then I'll tell you what's unique about it. Here's a little bit of that.
And sometimes when we touch, the honesty is too much.
All right, so people are familiar with that of a certain age. But here's the deal. On this day in 1978, on the Billboard charts, the top five songs, this was the only one not written or sung by a member of the Bee Gees. That's how big the Bee Gees were back then, is you had Andy Gibb at number one with Love is Thicker Than Water. Staying Alive was at number two. Dan Hill here was at number three. Night Fever was at number five. And at number four was Samantha Sang with the song Emotion, which was written by Robin and Barry Gibb. So a lot of Bee Gees fever back then, Selena.
Yeah.
I have to tell you how I think I know that song.
Oh dear. Okay.
Was it a slow skate?
I think it was on Days of Our Lives, like Bo and Hope scene or something like that.
Yep.
It's Days of Our Lives.
I could totally see it. On this day in 2020, Garth Brooks, at the age of 58, became the youngest recipient of the Library of Congress Gershwin Prize, which is given to a composer or a performer for a lifetime of contribution to popular music. Past recipients of the award include Joni Mitchell, Smokey Robinson, Carole King, Tony Bennett, Willie Nelson, Billy Joel, Paul McCartney, and Garth Brooks became the youngest ever winner of that at 58. So that's a pretty cool honor that he received 4 years ago today. Let's see. The Rolling Stones had their fourth number one hit this day in 1967 with Ruby Tuesday. Badfinger's Day After Day was certified gold this day in 1972. Here I've got a local one for you, Selena. Do you remember when that train derailed in Wyawega and caused the evacuation of more than 2,000 people for 16 days?
Yes.
Do you remember what year that was? It was on this day in?
Oh, I don't know the year.
1996.
96.
Oh, yeah. I was a senior in high school. Okay.
Moving on. On this day in 1993, there were about 400 hopefuls at a London dance studio auditioning for producers who were forming a new group. And it was on this day in 1993 that three of those 400 ladies, Melanie Chisholm, Melanie Brown, and Victoria Adams, were selected and would later be joined by Jerry Halliwell and Emma Burden for a little group known as the Spice Girls.
Don't you know? Why can't you see? Slow it down, read the signs, say you know just where you're going.
And on behalf of your daughters, it's Emma Bunton, not Burton. Respect the Baby Spice.
Did I say Bunton or Burton?
You said Burton.
Oh, I didn't mean to. Yes,
buddy.
It says Bunton here. My old eyes just completely whiffed on that one.
These eyes. Do.
This is March 4th, which, of course, everybody has fun with because it's a command. And as a result, today is National Marching Band Day. Today is also Hug a GI Day. There's some dissidence here. I don't know. It's National Obesity Day, but it's also National Snack Day and National Pound Cake Day.
Oh,
so, a pound of cake after dinner.
Yeah. It's National Safety Day. It's Global Day of the Engineer. It's National, not choo-choo, it's, you know, the drafting guys, National Grammar Day. So please speak very goodly today.
Ooh,
it is like HPV Awareness Day, and it is Game Master Day. So for all you game masters out there, this one's for you. Coming up after a little bit of news here, Selena's going to tell us what she's working on for Up North News, things that you can find on our website at upnorthnewswi.com on this March 4th. Back in a bit. You're Up North. Time.